my name is Frank Clooney. I'm the director of the Center for the Study of World Religions and would like, on behalf of the center, to welcome you for this wonderful conference. I know many of you have come from far away, and many of you have had a very long set of connections with environmentalism and religion, ecology and religion, and I know that a good number of you were here 20 years ago for the conferences that we had back in 96 to 98. And I think that was the starting inspiration. It was about 2 years ago that I sent Mary Evelyn and John an email saying, well, 1996, 2016 would be 20 years since the original conferences. Wouldn't it be fitting to have some kind of an event here to recollect, take assessment of where things were 20 years ago and where they are now, and then to move things forward? And 2 years later, with thousands of emails and thousands of back and forth, all the communications, we are here today. So I think it's a wonderful moment. 20 years ago was indeed a monumental time. And I think, though, I'm proud to say that the center in Harvard Divinity School have in various ways tried to keep the flame alive, not on the grand scale that some of you are involved in, but in small ways. We have a community garden you can see behind the dean's house. We have solar panels on the roof of the center. My predecessor is director Don Swearer, published in 2009 a book, Ecology and the Environment, 2011, Ecologies of Human Flourishing. And then we've had some conferences here in recent years on a smaller scale. In 2014, Spiritual and Sustainable, that involved many of our staff as well as students, faculty, and people from the community. And then just a few months ago in April, Spirit of Sustainable Agriculture, Engaging Farmers, Religious and Spiritual Leaders, and Academics. So while this is the big event, and this is the event that we hope will trigger new energy and new interest in these issues here at Harvard, we are proud to say that there's been some effort in between to keep things moving forward. I will turn things over in a moment to Mary Evelyn and John to give their introduction, and then we'll begin our first session rather promptly at 1:30. But I would just say that I think I'm not an environmentalist. I mean, I'm like most people concerned about the issues. More of my own work is Hindu Christian studies and classical Hinduism and the like. But I find this obviously very, very important and also intellectually very stimulating. I mean, if you think of the things that will be juggled in the next several days, on the one hand, where the science is, where the thinking about the environmental issues are, there's so many technical advances have been made in 20 years. Sadly, in many cases, the state of the earth is in terrible plight, and so much we have to worry about, and we see the devastating effects of climate change on our planet. Conversely, the study of religion has changed greatly in 20 years. How we talk about the different religions that we call Christianity or Hinduism or Buddhism or Islam, Judaism, and so on, we talk about them in the plural, we talk about them in multiple fashions, and we're very, very aware that they are now studied in ways that are different from 20 years ago. We're also aware that a conference like this really asks us not simply to talk about the history of religions, but the geography and place of religions. So where are when we talk about Judaism? Where are we when we're talking about Buddhism and so on? And it's just an incredible range of things that are being brought together in the sessions that we have today, tomorrow, and Sunday, which I think will also therefore exemplify not only how we do thinking about ecology and religion as a field, but also about how we rethink the interdisciplinary work of the sciences and of the study of religion and of all the practical issues where we want to see the payoff for what we do. So I think these are exciting days before us, and we want to use our time as well as possible. We'll make the space available to you. We hope that you'll be able to come over to the receptions across the street at the center, and that our conversations will be in the room and outside the room as well. I'm happy now to turn things over to Mary Evelyn and John.
How delightful it is. Living religion. People talk about the welcoming spirit of living religion. The second opening line of the Analects has this delightful moment of how delightful it is when friends gather from afar. It's the shared interest of friends, and to feel this pulling together, the gravity of our coming together, and my happy task to both welcome you and thank you for coming to participate in religion and ecology and our planetary future. Of course, thanks extend to you as participants and presenters, and to Frank especially for organizing, and to Marishik, our deep thanks, and also for the advisors and supporters over these many decades. Marty Kaplan has just walked in over here, and his lovely wife Wendy we'll see later, and I'm thinking that Nancy and Dick Clavins will be here from the Germishausen Foundation. Am I right, Nancy and Dick? Are they here? And I'm thinking also Stephen Rockefeller, your work at Middlebury College, Spirit and Nature, seminal initiating work for this project. So we reach back and obviously feel that support from our intellectual ancestors, and we extend gratitude then to all our ancestors, intellectual, historical, biological, and cosmological. In my tradition of study, the elders say it's always appropriate to remember those who walked on this land before us, so I wanted also to ask their permission, that are with us in this audience in their own way. And Mary Evelyn, let's do this together.
Thank you. So we want to, again, welcome and set a context. We are living, as we know, in one of the most challenging periods in history, a time when especially ethnic, cultural, religious, and national identities are being fiercely claimed by various groups, and when conflict is evident in every part of the world. This conflict is being expressed between individuals and nation states, but also between humans and the Earth itself. The assault on the Earth is almost without limits, and many feel this will be our ultimate downfall unless we can avert major ecological breakdown and discover new roles for humans as caretakers of Earth and not simply takers of its resources. This is one of the roles of the field of religion and ecology in this new Anthropocene period as humans become a planetary force. The promises of modernity have been endless. Economic comfort, leisure time, participatory government, individual freedoms. But these promises appear unattainable for many as the inequities and inequalities of some societies, such as the US, become more evident. Moreover, the militarism we have spawned is leading to a destructive arms race around the world, even larger than the Cold War. There is thus a looming sense of uncertainty about the future. We are in need of enduring visions of reality that are healing and sustaining for the human spirit and the spirit of the earth as well. This is where religious and spiritual perspectives have roles to play. The upheaval that we are experiencing has an uneasy feeling to it because there are so few viable ways forward that seem to have authenticity and depth. Our political and economic institutions are failing us. We need not elaborate that here. Our academic institutions, with their siloed approach to knowledge, seem inadequate to the task of transformation. There's much talk about the need for interdisciplinary courses, but the specialized training and reward systems of academia don't lend themselves to this approach, in case you didn't notice. This is why bringing together religion and ecology has been such a challenge, beginning here at Harvard, but in many other contexts as well, both academic and non-academic. It is also why being able to celebrate 20 years of this field with you here is remarkable. We are grateful to all who have contributed to the emergence of this new field against opposition, skepticism, or indifference, and we look forward to creating new paths forward with you. Here this weekend, we have an opportunity to re-examine the traditions of the world's cultures as we seek fresh sources of wisdom for our times. For example, revivals of Confucianism, Taoism, and Buddhism in China are underway, along with attempts to control this growth. A question for us, as James Miller's paper raises too, is can we assist, Chinese and non-Chinese alike, in encouraging the modern transformations of these and many other traditions for environmental concerns? This is true of all the world's religious and philosophical traditions.
We are inheriting the wisdom traditions of Asia and the West, as well as those of indigenous peoples in the Americas, the Pacific region, and Africa. These traditions are being reconstructed in the fire of change that is so great as to require each of the world's wisdom traditions to enter new phases in responding to social and ecological challenges. The question is, how can their various particularities be brought forward along with the search for common grounds for the larger Earth community? Beyond our differences is the call of the Earth itself to a shared future for coming generations. And this will require the efforts of all of us, scholars and activists, spiritual seekers and cultural reformers, religious and non-religious alike. The times, too, will demand standing up to power and greed, as in the example of the Standing Rock Hunkpapa Lakota, encamped on the high plains of North Dakota to protect their water, land, and sacred sites. Engaged scholarship is aligned with such transformative change. Clearly, all the traditions in their modern transformations have special gifts to offer our ecological discussions at this moment in history. We acknowledge, as we did 20 years ago, that they have their problems and their promise. Religions are often otherworldly oriented or doctrinaire and intolerant. They are not the answer, but one part of the solutions being offered. And their sheer size would indicate that they cannot be ignored. 1 billion Muslims, 1 billion Hindus, 1 billion Confucians, 2 billion Christians. The United Nations Environment Program speaks of religions as the largest non-governmental organizations on the planet. Moreover, we recognize, as we did 2 decades ago, that broader spiritualities are part of these discussions, not simply institutional forms of religion or the dogma of traditions, but also the lived practices of people around the world, which are deeply interwoven into daily life. We recognize elite culture and folk culture can seem quite different, and yet they coexist and mutually shape one another. And finally, we acknowledge the syncretic and intertwined nature of these traditions, especially, for example, in East Asia, where the three traditions of Confucianism, Taoism, and Buddhism were often labeled as one.
So to do this work, we realized we need partners. And from the very beginning, we had what we called SEEP, science, education, economics, and policy. And we just want to say that in the last 20 years, they have developed hugely as well. And part of this is the intersection that we're trying to foster, all of us. But if we take science, just one example is last August at the Ecological Society of America, the president, past president, and future president endorsed the papal encyclical, which was unheard of for 10,000 ecologists to take that stand. It had ripple effects through the other science organizations. Sustainability sciences have arisen here at Harvard and elsewhere. In terms of education, we have courses now represented in part in this program that weren't even conceived of. Religion and animals, climate change, food issues, and eco-justice issues that were not on the horizon. It's amazing to think of. But they're represented in this conference. They're represented in the educational world as well. In terms of economics, we have a lot of people working on new economics. And that's why Gus Speth will be here on Sunday to talk about his new system economics. But many of you have referenced the gift economy, a sense even of a cosmocentric economy. In terms of policy, the sustainability studies, areas towards global governance, the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, are calling to the voices of the religious communities to work with them on these issues as well. So, as we briefly touch on what we've called the field and the force of religion and ecology, we want to just say, certainly we began these with the traditions in a world religions approach. The syncretic approach, the inclusive approach, the on-the-ground approach was with us from the beginning, needs to be lifted up even more so. And that is in part one of the many things that we will hope to do in the further realization in this field together with you. So the field of religion and ecology.
I thought it would be interesting to just briefly glance over this emerging field of religion and ecology in the context of religious studies. And it's interesting that religious studies is a relatively new field arising in public and private universities in the United States in the late 1950s. And I'm interested in the Canadian reading also in relationship to this. In this secular context then, religious studies moved beyond its denominational origins in theology. Religious studies had its beginnings in a multidisciplinary approach, history of religion, sociology of religion, philosophy of religions. Yet it has also had a shared appreciation of itself, of the study of religion, as an integral dimension of cultures. In its early investigations, religious studies explored various experiences of the sacred, and then acknowledging the Durkheimian attention to the separation of the sacred and the profane, these studies began to move into world religions and comparative religions. Such cultural studies opened up new language and new approaches to the study of religion. Almost simultaneously, interreligious dialogue began to explore practical social justice, environmental justice, and conceptual issues regarding the encounter of religious traditions historically and at present. It is in this context, then, that religion and ecology initially emerged, motivated by the insights from environmental science and policy from the 1970s. And it's interesting to reflect that even in this setting of Harvard, such individuals as Gordon Kaufman and Richard Niebuhr here at the Divinity School, and Joseph Sittler and John Cobb and Paul Sampmeyer involved in conversations in Chicago in late 50s, early 60s, Rosemary Ruther in different settings, Sally McFay, Gordon's student, continuing these discussions with ultimate questions about the nature and names of God. And other leaders in these early years were helping them to develop this field of religion and ecology. So it's in this context and from these thinkers that religion and ecology has emerged from the understanding of ecology as both a science and a metaphor of deep interdependence of genetic, biological, geological, and cosmological interrelationships. In this sense, the question of the origin of religion has receded, and the dynamic character of lived religion has come to the fore. My own studies in indigenous First Nations, American Indian, Native American traditions have made me pointedly aware of such a term as lifeway, and many of you will know the term life world from Tim Ingold, similarly used to describe the interrelatedness of existence as a seamless sacred circle in which a people dwell. As a field, then, religion and ecology has a variety of global expressions, but it focuses on the dynamic and differentiated encounters with nature as a generative matrix that we are now unraveling at our own peril.
So contemporary expressions of this field are quite remarkable, actually. Just this year alone, two new handbooks on religion and ecology, one published by Rutledge, one published by Wiley Blackwell with John Hart as the editor, adding to valuable books by Roger Gottlieb and Bron Taylor earlier on in Encyclopedia. But the organizations are also exploding, national and international. The International Society for Nature, Culture, and Religion, Sarah Pike is here, formerly led by Bron Taylor. The European Forum for Study of Religion and Environment, Sigurd Bergman, Celia Dean Drummond, and others, and the Consortium for the Study of Religion, Ethics, and Society at Indiana University, led by Lisa Sedaris. Most amazingly, though, there are six new jobs in this field this year. Astounding. Astounding. That includes UC Santa Barbara, Santa Clara, Carleton College, St. Olaf's, the University of North Texas, and Dartmouth. The field is coming of age, but so are the challenges. And that's the force that we want to highlight as well, the force of religion and ecology.
We know that the engaged side of the study of religion and ecology is more than just religion as institutions. We know this well from the participation of indigenous peoples in North America and other parts of the world standing up to protect water, soil, and air. Similarly, these developments in the engaged dimensions of religion are matched by thinkers such as Les Sponsel and his drawing attention to spiritual ecology, and Bron Taylor's emphasis over the years on nature and culture. We've already suggested that lived practices and life ways shape people's daily life and seasonal rituals all around the world, but many of these people are led by religious leaders who have now given voice to these issues. We all know the Dalai Lama for years has attended in Tibet from Tibetan Buddhism. Now his younger colleague, the 17th Karmapa, and other Tibetan Buddhist leaders are speaking up. In the Confucian realm, Du Wei Ming is a voice from some time, and also we begin to feel ecological culture articulating itself in China. Catherine Hayhoe, of the evangelical scientist, has made inroads into the evangelical community, bringing her steady, even, unflappable voice into these issues. And so also mentioning the Native American peoples and First Nations in Canada. I mean, they are leaders with regard to this sense of environmental protection, especially in the Northwest Coast. So we have a number of leaders and activities, and the organizations in the U.S., Canada, throughout the world are remarkable. Interfaith Power and Light, a few examples, they're in nearly every state. Green Faith in New Jersey, Faith in Place in Chicago, Earth Ministry, decades in Seattle. And finally, Interreligious Eco-Justice Network in Hartford, Connecticut, just to mention a few.
So we have now statements of all the world's religions that were not there 20 years ago. But I want to end these comments with, I think, probably the most significant statement that has come out that is affecting people all over the planet, and that is the Pope's encyclical, Laudato Si. This is surely one of the most notable examples of religion and ecology in a certain way of its visibility, but it's addressed to all people on the planet. And clearly, 2 billion Christians are beginning to take it seriously. It will take time. It's not going to happen tomorrow. But this notion of integral ecology, bringing together people and the planet, is absolutely incomparable. And in this context, Francis suggests that ecology, economics, and equity are intertwined. Healthy ecosystems depend on a just economy that fosters equity. Many of these points are being made in the climate panel that we'll have here. Endangering ecosystems with an exploitive economic system is causing immense human suffering and inequity. The Pope acknowledges the need for believers and non-believers alike to help renew the vitality of Earth's ecosystems and expand systemic efforts for equity. He provides a cosmological and ecological context for the eco-justice agenda. For the last 20 years, we have been advisors, along with Leonardo Boff and Sean McDonough, to a series from Orbis Books on ecology and justice. A key book in that series is Leonardo Boff's Cry of the Earth, Cry of the Poor, which is a central theme to the encyclical. And we must bring in Thomas Berry's name here, who had a huge influence on Leonardo Boff and clearly on the encyclical in that way, too. So thus, to conclude, with the encyclical, with many new publications and growing organizations, with 6 new positions in religion and ecology, this year we can say, with thanks to all of you and thousands of others, that the field of religion and ecology has indeed emerged over the last 2 decades. We look forward to seeing even more robust growth in the decades ahead. In so doing, we humans may find our way forward in rejoining the larger Earth community. Thank you so very much. I just want to also say, we were just at the climate change discussions with Harvard, and Reverend Mariana White Hammond is here, who did a magnificent job in that. Would you just raise your hand over there, Mariana? Thank you so much. Thank you.
You can see that artful back and forth, Mayor Evelyn and John. That's how it works. 2 people do better than 1. So we are going to plow ahead here. Just a reminder on the housekeeping, because we have such short breaks, 15 minutes, anytime you need to get up and go out, the restrooms are downstairs, there's coffee in the brown room, just sort of delicately go out and delicately come back. You don't have to stand in the corners or anything. Just come in and plow back to your seat. So I think we're a relaxed group, and we needn't worry about that. But I would now invite that we'll go right into our first panel. So I'd invite Hava, Tirosh-Samuelson, Heather Eaton, and Mohammed Rustom to come up and take their places at the table. And I would just, as they are finding their seats, I would just remind all of us that on the one hand, we have asked our panelists, maybe particularly today and tomorrow morning, to do an impossible task.
Yes.
The different religious traditions, their take on environmental issues, how things were 20 years ago, how they are now, and where they're going, and have 12 minutes each or so to do this. The only alleviating...
Just forget it.
The alleviating factor was that at Dropbox, which I hope you have access to, talk to us during the break if you can't find it, there are 4 or 5 page summaries of people's statements. The reason we're limiting it to 12, 13 minutes is that there'll be plenty of time for discussion. So we're grateful to our speakers for taking on this task courageously. And I'll just introduce them briefly because their bios are also in Dropbox. So Hava Tirosh-Samuelson is at Arizona State University. Her most recent book is Perfecting Human Futures, Transhuman Visions and Technological Imaginations, 2016 Springer. Heather Eaton is at St. Paul's University in Ottawa. And her most recent books are in 2014, The Intellectual Journey of Thomas Berry, Imagining the Earth Community, and in 2016, with Lauren Levesque, Advancing Nonviolence and Social Transformation, New Perspectives on Nonviolent Theories. And then Mohammed Rustom at Carleton University in Ottawa, his forthcoming book, Inrushes of the Spirit, The Mystical Theology of Ayn al-Qudat. And so we have three very expert and bold speakers to lead us off today. And I invite Hava to go first.
Can I go there?
Yep.
Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. It's wonderful to see you all here. And let me start by thanking Francis Clooney and Mary Evelyn and John for putting together this exciting conference. All of us in the field of religion and ecology are indebted to their vision, determination, and commitment to generate a global interfaith conversation that has made it clear that our current environmental crisis could not be addressed without attention to religion. The efforts of Mary Evelyn and John and all the people sitting here in the room, we are brought together to celebrate the series of Ecology and World Religions that started here in 1996. And I think all of us would agree that it could not have happened without Mary Evelyn and John. So let's take a moment to thank them first. So we all recognize that a lot has been done, much still remains to be done, and I would like to ask the question, where does Judaism fit into the field of religion and ecology? So in February 1997, when the Conference on Judaism and the Natural World was held here, the conversation just began. The volume that I edited, Judaism and Ecology, Created World and Revealed Word, testified not only to the newness of the conversation, but also to some of the difficulties that plagued that conversation. The contributors to the volume were aware that they are treading on new grounds and that they are bringing to the fore new theoretical issues that require new thinking and new analytical framework. In retrospect, it is easy to see, at least for me, it is easy to see, that the Jewish conversation on ecology lacked a certain intellectual cohesion or clear theoretical framework. Thus, the volume was more as an invitation to the field to enter the conversation and to examine Judaism in light of environmentalism, rather than an expression of accomplishment and set conventions. So let me put the development of the discourse in perspective for you so that you can appreciate how much was accomplished since the volume was published in 2002. Briefly put, 1970s, the conversation began basically it's an apologetic project in order to defend Judaism against the argument of Lynn White Jr. Everybody in the room knows it, so there's no reason to repeat those accusations. But Jewish theologians and religious leaders defended Judaism, arguing that the Jewish religion does not authorize exploitation of nature, but rather advocate the protection and conservation of nature. Published in Jewish journals, whose primary readership was Jewish, these essays explained how the belief in God as creator of the world leads to protection of that which properly belongs to God. They explicated biblical and rabbinic norms and values about the environment. They articulated the ethics of responsibility toward the earth and its inhabitants, and they highlighted the degree to which Judaism is not a glorification of nature, but a moral critique of nature. While Jewish theologians began to think through Jewish attitudes toward the environment, the academic field of religion and ecology developed as a distinct specialization within religious studies, and we just heard a summary of that field. Committed to interreligious comparative analysis of world religions, the discourse on religion and ecology stimulated the discourse on Judaism and the environment. Because Jewish scholars were invited to contribute essays to special volumes on religion and ecology and to identify what is distinctive about the Jewish approach to environmentalism. By the mid-1980s, it was firmly established that Judaism should not be seen as a contributing cause to the environmental crisis, but rather as one of the religious responses to it. However, convincing Jews that environmentalism should matter came not from rabbis and theologians, but from born Jews who were environmental activists who sought to ground their environmental sensibility in the Jewish tradition. And that's true both in the diaspora and in Israel. In other words, Jewish religious environmentalism began as a grassroots movement that would eventually make an impact on Jewish life and would gradually attract the interest of Jewish studies scholars. Founded by Ellen Bernstein, who is here? Ellen, show your, here we go. Ellen Bernstein is really, we all are indebted to her. She started it all. She created this organization called Shomrei Adama, Gardens of the Earth. And that organization illustrated the beginning of Jewish environmental activism. So this started the conversation, and a lot of things happened thereafter. Today, we have numerous Jewish environmental organizations. I won't inundate you with all the names because they probably won't mean much to the people sitting here. But it's not that we do have Jewish environmental activism, that's for sure. While Jewish environmentalism began to capture the imagination of Jews, especially young Jews, then there's really an age issue here. People under 40 are more susceptible, more interested than people above 60. That's more or less how it goes here in the Jewish community. The academic discipline of Jewish studies was rather slow to respond to the growing Jewish interest in environmentalism. The first session on Judaism and the environment at the annual conference of the AJS, the Association for Jewish Studies, was held only in 2003, and only five people were in the room. The same thing happened in 2008, and again, less than 10 people in a room. And since I was in both times, it was very depressing, I have to tell you. So clearly, the academic discourse on Judaism and environment, it has grown. We have a lot more literature now, but there's much more to do. So what do we have today? We have anthologies, we have single authors' book, we have essays in reference books and encyclopedias, and we have essays in peer-reviewed journals. So it's going on. All the major themes are articulated. That has been accomplished. But again, I don't think that I can be very happy about the state of the field. I think that we have a lot more to go in terms of getting other people to be interested in it. It's still very much a marginal issue. It's kind of a hot button issue. It's a sexy issue. It's an exotic issue. But people are not really taking environmentalism as something that is existentially important. So in the presentation that I have available for today that you could read on the Dropbox, I basically made four major points. So let me go over those four points and you can read them fully online in the Dropbox material. The first point was to know the difficulty of defining Judaism because it challenges how we understand what we call religion. Even though we use the construct of religion and hold that there is a distinctive methodology that studies religion, namely the discipline of religious studies, Judaism definitely problematizes the definition of religion and urges us to understand religion holistically as a civilization that encompasses all aspects of life. Judaism is not just about beliefs and doctrines, but about a holistic way of life that has evolved over time and that is constantly changing. This civilizational approach to Judaism challenges a simplistic dichotomy between the religious and the secular dimensions of life, which Judaism has not had until the modern period. In order to be modernized and integrated into Western Christian society, Judaism has adopted that distinction. But the ongoing complexities of modern Judaism in Israel and in the diaspora indicate that a rigid distinction between the religious and the secular dimensions doesn't really work. There are too many gray areas and too many hybrids of secular religiosity or religious secularity, and that's making our life a little bit complicated. I'll go to that point. I'll come back to that point at the end when I speak about the post-secular age. My second point was that an attempt to give you a snapshot of Jewish environmentalism, differentiating between environmentalism in the diaspora and environmentalism in the state of Israel. In Israel, there is a lot of environmental activity. It's too much to be, I cannot make any attempt to summarize it here. But it is not necessarily rooted in Judaic beliefs. Although some activities do, and traditional Jewish environmental values in fact frame some contemporary legislation. Judaism offers us a model of for the nexus of religion, law, and ethics that might be, I argue, more productive for tackling our acute environmental challenges than eco-theology or eco-hermeneutics. Now, not everybody will agree with me on that, but if you want justification for that point, I would suggest that we go to Israel and we see how Israel, for example, treats water. And I'll just briefly mention a few points about that because it's absolutely fascinating. There's a lot of legislation about water in Israel. The bottom line is that the natural resource is understood as something that belongs to the nation, not to individuals. And that means that the entire nation is responsible for the well-being of this natural resource. So that's one important point. Another important point in Israel, you can see how centralized planning can work in favor of the environment. Centralized planning is very important in Israel on all levels, governmental, municipal, regional. Third point in Israel, use of natural resources has, everything has real market price. And because there is real pricing, it encourages efficiency and conservation. And the fourth point is the importance of technological development. There's a lot of technological development in that particular area of water conservation. So it's absolutely fascinating what can be done with technology and how technology helps us to move forward. So all this is done in Israel, but the bottom line of the issue is that you can legislate about the environment and you can do an awful lot and do it well. In the diaspora, where Jews are just a tiny minority, environmentalism expresses itself theologically and hermeneutically. And there's no doubt that these efforts have made some impact on the lives of individual Jews, inspiring them to be environmentally concerned. However, it is very hard to assess the strength of Jewish environmentalism in the diaspora, and I tend to err on the side of caution. I resist the temptation to exaggerate. So the American Jewish community has made an effort to become green by initiating various practices, but environmentalism, I would contend, remains a marginal concern in terms of the agenda of the organized Jewish community. Other issues take precedence. My third point concerns the difference between Jewish environmentalism as an activist movement that responds to the environmental crisis and the academic discourse about environmentalism within Judaism. Here, the story is quite mixed. As I already indicated, a lot has been written about the topic in the past three decades. And if you want to read my bibliographical essay, I cover all these fields, 180 items, and I could have gone to more. So there's a lot out there. But still, I would submit that within Jewish studies, it's not really a topic that engages all of Jewish studies people. Those who are engaged, but the others still considered ecology or environment as antithetical to or alien to Judaism. Yes, I'm about to finish, yes. And what about the impact of Jewish environmentalism on the economy? Did Judaism make a difference to the economy? Well, here again, the story is quite even more complicated. One problem is the fact that most people who know the history of the environmental movement gloss over the fact that many of the people that we bring to mind when we talk about various aspects of environmentalism were Jews. They just don't pay attention to that. So we can, I would submit, you cannot think about animal liberation without Peter Singer. You cannot think about social ecology without Murray Bookchin. You cannot think about environmental ethics and green politics without Hans Jonas. You cannot think about ecophenomenology without Jacques Derrida, Emmanuel Levinas, and David Abram. And you can't think about ecofeminism without Star Hawk, Rianne Eisler, in case you don't know she's Jewish, Rianne Eisler, or Gloria Ornstein. So why do I mention them? Because when you begin to think about their Jewishness and their relevance to their environmentalism, you see how complicated it is to think about what is Jewish. Who is a Jew? What does it mean to be Jewish in the modern world? So the bottom line is where we are now, and that's my fourth point in the paper, is basically to suggest to us that we are in a new situation that I like to use the construct of the post-secular as the best way to think about the new situation, our contemporary moment. And in this contemporary moment, all the paradigms of modernity are basically challenged. And a major paradigm that is challenged is the distinction between fact and value, between the objectivity of nature and the subjectivity of the human self, between the disenchanted science and socially committed religion. So where are we going to go with that? I think we need some new paradigms now. We need to rethink many of the problems that we brought with us through the modern period. I remain optimistic. I guess that's my nature on some level. I do believe that our particular way, namely our people here in religion and ecology field, our particular way of framing the issues can successfully mobilize people, especially young people, to act better than our other discourses within environmental studies. And for this reason, I remain optimistic, even though the evidence about our environmental challenges gets more and more dire. My hopeful posture is itself an expression of my Jewishness, a religious tradition that frames the future as an open-ended and unpredictable while inviting all of us to act in the present. As Tractate Avot teaches us, it is not for you to complete the task, but neither are you free to desist from it. Thank you.
Thank you also to the organizers, to colleagues, to friends. It's really lovely to be with colleagues with whom I've worked for almost 30 years. My task is Christianity. The paper I wrote is Retrospective, Introspective, Prospective. For the retrospective part, I just think it's mandatory to mention Lynn White. So, Lynn White. From a Christian point of view, the reinterpretation and the creativity that's happened over the past 30 years have really governed much of this ecological transformation of Christianity. And it really is a reformation and new expressions. Christianities have really responded with suppleness and vitality, and it's really quite extraordinary. In the other paper I wrote, I mentioned two intellectual horizons that I think are important. Both of them involve the natural world, and one is attentiveness to new ways that the complexity and vitality of life, from snowflakes to dinosaurs, fractals, cosmology, that these are requiring an eco-literacy in theology. So that's the breadth of nature. And there's also another move to enter into the depth of nature, to see the ingenuity and creativity, the immense beauty and the ineffable presence that the natural world exudes. So this breadth and depth of the natural world is shaping eco-theology. So for this time, I just want to mention four challenges that I see for the prospective part. And the first is all these efforts to revise Christianities. So I would say that creation theologies, liberation theologies, eco-justice are overall well-developed and continuing. There are obstacles in the tradition, and these are not agreed upon. Anthropocentrism has been challenged, I would say remains intact. Christologies are less well-addressed. But the one that concerns me most is the notion of salvation. The crass notions of salvation as an escape from the confines of this sinful existence have somewhat disappeared. Life is no longer a long night in a bad hotel, as says Teresa of Avila. Eco-theologies have done a good job of rethinking continuities between cosmos, earth, evolution, and divine. And I quote from Moltmann, "God will indwell creation on earth as in heaven." So that's fine, but he carries on and says, "But death will be no more. all things will participate in the eternal livingness and righteousness of God. Now here it's the tenaciousness of the belief that life here is inadequate, incomplete, flawed, and temporary. Christianity guarantees eternity. Earthly life is seen as a promise, a potential, a prediction of life to come in this process of becoming towards a perfection of all things in which humans always seem to remain central. Moltmann writes, the perfected creation does not lie behind us in a primal state, but ahead of us in a final one. We are now existing in its prehistory. Now personally, and this is my view, salvation, redemption, resurrection, eternity are all theologically problematic. They're epistemologically frail, and I think they indicate a refusal to accept the conditions of life, which are vulnerability, mortality, and finitude, from Ivan Ejabara. I think that these beliefs about a post-death bodily resurrection, an otherworldly afterlife, and eternal life need to be completely abandoned. I think they prevent awareness of the delicacy and elegance of life, and they prevent reverence, and they prevent crusading for the biosphere, and you know Christians love crusading. I think this fortress of salvation theology is really a problem to take earthly life seriously. I do realize that when they restart burning women at the stake, I will be the first to go. Second challenge. Christianity has proven to be more malleable and vital than I would have said 30 years ago and even 20 years ago at the Harvard conference. Even the Vatican has changed with Laudato Si, although we're still waiting on gender. But meanwhile, the ecological crisis has escalated. So the question for me in ecotheology is, how do we assess relevance? Christianity clearly has ample insights and resources for an ecological era. But what is relevant? What is beneficial in this era of decline? It's great to change our thinking, reconstruct the tradition, explore new rituals, but it has to translate into more. Those of us who have done this for most of our adult life, the changes are so minuscule compared to the mounting ecological issues. We have many hermeneutics to assess interpretations and meanings, but how do we assess relevance? The question of social and political traction, what will influence change? How does our intellectual work and our intense probing of these traditions, how does this change society? Many of us are educators, but how does education actually translate into social transformation? How can anything we do be commensurate to what needs to be done? I'm not saying this to engender despair, but it's really to assess our future efforts, how to be relevant for social change. The last two comments I have are about concerns. And one is the role of intellectual work. So I'm drawing here from Andrew Ronsley, who's a British political journalist who writes about the rise of the irrational, politics dominated by sound bites, the lack of political debate in society, democratic disengagement, media landscapes of political infotainment, and political spins. He says the irrational and the distortion are actually dominating public discourse. Lying is determining political discourse. Fabrications, he says, quote, public discussions are replete with bile, deceit, and confusion. So if the triumph of the irrational is characterizing political debates, and this is not just Donald Trump, but I must say he is hard to surpass, there is a rise of right-wing hardened political positions going on in Europe and Japan and other places in the world. So my question is, how can civic society debate values, public policy, social cohesion, ecological compromises which are going to be needed, and ethics? So where is the intellectual work relevant? I think the university is one of the last places left for these debates, and it is the antidote to the rise of irrationality. So my question is the role of the university in creating the tenor of civic society, in contributing to public policy and social transformation. Those of us who work in universities, how can we safeguard, even strengthen, this role at the university? And that's our work in religion and ecology. And my last point are new intellectual directions, and these are, again, concerns. So I look at the work of Journey of the Universe, which I'm going to assume all of you know, this big project of Mary Evelyn and John, this very new understanding of the parameters and the dynamics of reality, how deeply embedded and entangled humans are into all aspects of the macro, meso, and micro scheme of things. And there are two other competing narratives I want to mention, and maybe they only concern me, and these are two books that are getting a great deal of attention in intellectual circles in Canada. The first one is by Yuval Harari, Homo Deus, A Brief History of Tomorrow. Now, he's a book who wrote Sapiens, A Brief History of Humankind, which was translated into 40 languages. He says that human nature is at an evolutionary leap. Intelligence is being uncoupled from consciousness because Homo sapiens now live in a data-driven world. Artificial intelligence, genetic and bioengineering. He says that we are in the process of developing a new narrative that legitimizes the authority of algorithms and big data, as he calls it. It's dataism. So Harari sees the power of biotechnology and algorithms as divine abilities. Vast data processing networks. They know our feelings, our preferences. They map our desires. They process our behaviors. That is intelligence. Google, the search engine, not the company, doesn't have beliefs and desires, doesn't care what we search for, is not hurt by our behavior, but soon it will determine our behavior. Mm-hmm. And this is very true of younger people. Humans can be interpreted as units of information, algorithms, data processing machines. And this, in his book, is all confirmed through science. The trouble is the algorithms that we've built are far more intelligent and efficient than we are. Self-driving cars, for example. This data-driven evolutionary transformation is occurring, and it is altering political structures and systems of meaning. So this decoupling of intelligence and consciousness has great consequences, many of which are unforeseen. If we can imagine those of us in coming from religious traditions or working within them or outside of them, but the role of religion, how can we imagine intelligence severed from a social ethics, social conscience, consciousness? Harari says that there are few points of resistance, but one of them is religion. And the second book I want to mention is Beyond Biocentrism, Rethinking Time, Space, Consciousness, and the Illusion of Death. This is by Robert Lanza, who's a biologist. He has been quoted as one of the top 50 thinkers of the world in 2015. He says that if we accept the full impact of science, quantum physics, entanglement theories, and merging of the observed and the observer, we have to be opposed to material realism. It's a quantum worldview versus a classical worldview. He's opposed to logical realism, and he promotes biocentrism. But this is not a biocentrism based in biology. This is a biocentrism based in physics. And he says, really, it's based in human consciousness. Human consciousness is the power of reality. Space and time are not accurate categories for understanding anything. Cosmology, Big Bang, the expanding universe, evolution, emerging complexity, these are all old paradigms. Everything in this worldview he's proposing, and there are many in this worldview, everything has to be understood within the matrix of consciousness. Life, awareness, perception, time and space are tools of the mind. Everything is relational. It looks like the new materialism, but it's really a form of human consciousness. Everything is anchored in human consciousness. He also talks about algorithms. He says the mind is the human algorithm, creates the illusion of perceiving, and then it vanishes. There is no spatial-temporal reality. What we perceive only exists in our mind, in neurochemical meanderings. Foundations are non-existent. Death is also unreal, which is kind of handy. Now, these are probably old philosophical questions packaged in new sciences. Does anything really exist? Personally, I found this book sloppy, kind of a collage-style argument, and taking precise experiments on particles and molecules and extrapolating outward. However, this worldview is gaining a great deal of attention in intellectual frameworks, and it should not be ignored. My point is that for both of these authors and these traditions, the natural world is not there. It's completely absent. Religion is passé. So, what are the implications for our work, our perspectives, commitments, and insights within these other compelling narratives? And these are some of the perspective challenges I see. Thank you.
Thank you all very much. Heather, those last remarks were very interesting, where you dealt with the question of consciousness. You read my mind on one level. So no pun intended. Now, I originally wanted to bring an image with me. Unfortunately, I'm so bad with computers, and I don't even own a cell phone, so I couldn't bring the image with me, so you just have to like visualize it. And this will, I hope, make sense to you. About 10 years ago, I was in Saudi Arabia. And anyone who's been to the Middle East, you're aware of one very common phenomena, which is that cigarette smoke is everywhere. Yes. Everybody smokes. Even like young children smoke in some places. So here I am, it was 10 years ago, 2006, I'm in Saudi Arabia, and I was in Mecca, of all places, which is, it's a valley, it's extremely hot. And you wouldn't really find too many environmental messages in a place like that for various reasons. It's a religious, kind of like a cultural district almost, but it's also an important commercial district. The Saudi Arabian government has done a lot in the last 20 years to really take away the sacred quality of that place. And so by calling attention to like environmental problems, this might get people to think too much. So the image that I saw surprised me. There were billboards, and it was like a cigarette, like a big cigarette like this, and there was a man, a Saudi Arabian man with the traditional turban or the iqal, and he's standing at the edge of the cigarette. And there's like a sign in Arabic, it says, be careful not to fall over. Or another one would be, the man would be there and he would be like hanging off of the tip of the cigarette. So he's like hanging, and it says, one more puff and you'll fall. Or things like this. They don't come out too well in English, but the rhetorical effect in Arabic was very significant. So I started thinking around that time about the environmental crisis in the Muslim world. What was the motivation behind this kind of picture, this cigarette smoke, don't pollute the environment? Is it just for human health? Is it a bit of both? And so I started digging up sources, and I found that in the Arabic language, there are tons of books, like many, many, many books, on the environmental crisis. And some of the earlier fatwas or legal edicts by Saudi Arabian scholars in the early 90s had identified cigarette smoke as a very important contributor to what they call tawalluth in Arabic, which is like the pollution, environmental pollution. So I think the reason these things were there was because of a growing awareness amongst Arabic-speaking audiences, which would be about 300 million Muslims worldwide, concerning the effects of just such things that had never been really discussed except for legal reasons, like cigarette smoke. Then I started looking at other texts written by important legal jurists in the Muslim world, looking for texts that dealt with the environmental crisis as an intellectual problem. There, I was very surprised to learn that although there are many books written by very prominent Muslim intellectuals in the Arabic world, like Yusuf Qaradawi in 2001, he wrote a book on the environmental crisis about how it's against Islamic law to pollute the environment. Before that, 10 years before him, there was an author, Abdul Jawad Abdul Wahab, who probably wrote the first book in Arabic on the Islamic method for the curing of the environmental crisis. When you look through these works, what you discover is that the vast majority of them are addressing the environmental crisis from a legal or a social standpoint. So You have many works and even fatwas issued by primary major clerics in Iran in the last 10 years that look at the environmental crisis not necessarily as a philosophical or spiritual problem, but just as an Islamic legal problem. So this makes sense on one level. I understand why that would be the case, because Islam, being a religion that's based largely on law, requires the knowledge of how to act properly. And whenever new situations arise, you need to know, okay, so this new introduction of cars in Muslim society, let's say in the late 19th century, what did that mean to Muslims as a religious duty? Should we drive the car? Should we not drive the car? What about, what will that do to, like, how will that affect your daily prayers, going to the mosque, for example? We have reports in the tradition that you should walk to the mosque. We don't have reports that you should drive to the mosque. So, like, the legal questions, like, they're centered around these kinds of things. Can we infer, using texts, like, some kind of analogies, how we can understand these new things that are introduced into the Muslim world on a legal level? Of course, if we look at the environmental problem as just a legal problem, and just as a political problem, even if you couch it in religious terms, it raises a number of questions. One, is it just a legal problem? Is it just a political problem? Even if it has serious religious implications, what does that mean for individuals who, for example, read verses in the Quran where it says that everything praises God? If everything praises God, that would also include the trees, that would also include the rivers. On legal terms, it's very difficult to frame that kind of an understanding from the Quran in terms of your sense of duty if you don't see the tree or the river as somehow living. If it's just an inert piece of matter that you have to respect because you have some reports in the Islamic tradition that say you should respect, let's say, trees. There's a famous report the Prophet said, don't harm your mother, when he was referring to the earth. And of course, cutting down trees is not allowed in Islamic law. But if you just see it as something like that's a duty and not as protecting a living being, then of course I believe you're contributing to a mechanistic understanding of nature, which ironically is the same kind of picture and worldview that gave rise, by and large, to the environmental crisis to begin with. So how do we begin to think about nature as a living thing, in this case with respect to the Islamic tradition? These are some of the thoughts that started occurring to me in this early period, about a decade ago. Now, myself being trained in the Islamic intellectual tradition, I'm a scholar of Islamic philosophy and mysticism. I naturally looked to the Muslim philosophical, metaphysical texts for solutions. The thing that occurred to me just by even a cursory glance at these materials is that the worldview, the picture in Islamic metaphysics, the general understanding of the order of nature and from the cosmos all the way to little rocks in the ground is that everything is alive. Everything is alive. And they say that everything is conscious or awake. Recently, I had a colleague come from Senegal who's not, I don't think she's aware of the environmental crisis on any level, but I started introducing her to the idea of the environmental crisis as a philosophical problem. And without having read any books but being immersed in the Islamic spiritual tradition, she said to me, yes, we can't hurt the trees' feelings. And I thought, wow, so now the trees, like, they're like animated beings. So for her, it was very clear. It wasn't just a legal injunction, don't cut down the trees. It was like, we don't want to harm the tree because it's a living being. So one of the things that I see, that I hope to see more of in Islamic intellectual and spiritual circles going forward, is this understanding of the Islamic cosmos for especially younger Muslims who are stepping into this inherited worldview of a legal responsibility towards nature, to see it more as not just a legal responsibility, but also as a spiritual responsibility. And the teachings are there amongst some of the great Islamic thinkers that they can kind of be educated on this level of understanding. So the general argument goes something like this. You have God, who's supreme consciousness. Or in Arabic, they use the term awareness, or he's supreme finding, wujud. It can also mean ecstasy, and it can also mean being or existence. So God as being consciousness bliss, those of you in Hindu studies would recognize that reference, it manifests the world, and the world kind of emerges from God. There's different accounts here. I'm giving you like a more generalized one. And the order of nature that comes out of this consciousness consists of just lower, varying degrees of consciousness. The higher you go, the more consciousness there is. And the lower you go, the less consciousness there is. When you hit rock bottom, things are still conscious. So even a rock, from an Islamic metaphysical perspective, is still a living thing, which is why some of the Muslim philosophers have said that just as human beings will be resurrected and judged in the afterlife, and they'll go to heaven or to hell, so too will all lower forms of consciousness be resurrected, and in their case, they're not morally responsible, so they get to go back home. That includes, of course, animals, more so than they would rocks, but that also includes rocks and tables and plastic items and all kinds of things. So if you see the world in this way, where everything is conscious, it's alive, how much more likely is it that you will seek to protect it based on a religious imperative, not just on a moral imperative, but even on a religious imperative? If you see it as an extension of God's consciousness, and you see yourself as an extension of the divine consciousness, and you see everything else as just lower levels of that same conscious awareness, well, what kind of effect will that have upon your psyche when you see somebody, let's say, even just litter on the ground? It would hurt. It would actually hurt, maybe even physically. So there are some resources for this amongst some Islamic scholars. There have been books that have been written about this. We have some younger scholars who are doing work. Munjin Murad, I don't want to embarrass him back there. He's one of the leading younger generation of scholars who are working in this regard. Sayyid Hussein Nasser, the famous Muslim philosopher, he's probably the first person to have written from an Islamic perspective about the environmental crisis. Unfortunately, the insights that he has shared in the few books that he's written on this regard has not been heeded or followed in the Muslim world. But amongst Muslims in North America and Europe, I believe things are changing, hopefully for the better. Thank you very much.
So our speakers have been very diligent, and I didn't really have to use my little warnings here. So we have plenty of time, which is the point of such a wonderful audience, to participate in conversation. I think for the sake of, we don't have today a microphone, so I'd ask you to speak loud if you have a question. It can be, I'll try to, you know, feel them, address them to one of the speakers, or a question if you'd like to have all three speakers address. And I realize many of you have lots and lots of experience. If you can, you know, bring in your own opinion, but not turn it into a long thing, that would be okay. But don't be shy to express yourself if you can do it with a question mark at the end. Yes, please.
Well, I think I didn't know who to address this to, so can you suggest I could address it to all the speakers? My own involvement in analysis of why we are tanking, ecologically speaking, I've come up with the, I think, irrefutable recognition that we have a pseudo-religion on Earth that combines the numbers in all the religions, and that is money and economics. It's a secular religion. But, you know, the almighty dollar is just one utterance in language that indicates that I'm not totally barking up the wrong tree. And this influences Islam because Saudi Arabia obviously is an oil power. It influences Judaism because a lot of people say the banking industry is Goldman Sachs. You know, there's a relationship. I don't want to... I am Jewish.
Tread lightly here.
So it's...
Mea culpa here, yeah.
Okay, so, and also with Christianity, money rules the way. How do we, how do we confront that? How do we change that situation?
So you can all jump in any order. Help yourselves.
Don't, do you want to go first?
Whoever has the
inspiration. Okay, well, I guess we is a Jew to a Jew. Look, definitely capitalism is a problem. What can we do without it? I'm not sure that we have a better alternatives so far. And I'm from a kibbutz in Israel, so I'm a product of socialist, really communist, actually, system. And I can tell you that that doesn't work either, at least not in the big scheme of things, it doesn't really work. So it's not a situation that we can do without money, and there's no reason, in my mind, to demonize the people who create the economic engines that we need it. That's why I have a wonderful book that I highly recommend to all of us here. It's Let There Be Water by Seth Siegel. It's about the focusing primarily on water, but the complexity of the situation. It's about environmentalism in Israel and the impact of Israel all over the world. But the point of the book is that government, the banking industry, individuals, intellectuals, we all have to work together. It's not that you have one factor that is to be blamed for what has gone wrong. So I think it's a mistake to just, blame capitalism or blame the banking system. I don't think that that's going to help us moving forward. What we need is to bring technological innovation, thinking in new ways about economic challenges, and coming to terms with very concrete challenges. And just to blame something is not going to move us forward.
I would just add that I think consumerism is, as an ideology, is a very big problem. I think that's one place to confront it. It's the ideology of consumerism.
No, you brought up Saudi Arabia as a case. What they do with their money is largely concealed. There are all kinds of ways that they do that. There is an increased understanding, at least in terms of a massive amount of wealth that's passing or being passed around in places like Saudi Arabia and the Gulf states, that they need to do something with this money. So from a financial perspective, many of them have actually used their wealth to, let's say, better water and very simple things like this, create better water systems, better aqueduct systems. But that's just one level of treatment. Now, as a broader philosophical and metaphysical problem, I've always felt that materialism, it's the root of most evils, not just the environmental crisis, but so many things. And what is it about materialism? It's not necessarily the quantified view of the world only that's the problem, but it's really the worldview that informs that, which is not materialism, but it's scientism. So science is not a problem. Being a scientific person is not a problem. But if you're scientistic, that can lead to serious problems, because that's largely the worldview that gave rise to the many philosophical problems from the 17th century onwards, but in particular the environmental crisis. What happened in the 17th century, largely because of many developments from the Renaissance actually onward, was a view of nature in which the human subject was separate from other things. So they refer to this as the bifurcated nature of the cosmos. In the new physics, there have been all these attempts to demonstrate how we're actually intertwined intimately in ways that are quite mind-boggling, and which like affirm more what the pre-modern authors had said about the nature of things. But that really hasn't caught on much, definitely not in university systems, like Fritjof Capra's The Tao of Physics and all of these books. That's only still read by a handful of people. In the physics department, if you ask them, they'll usually tell you this is just junk science or something like this, even though they may affirm a lot of the principles that they're reporting. So scientism has the ability to objectify, but also distance the subject from the object. And that's what leads to a quantified nature of things, when you start seeing things as discrete realities that you can like put under a microscope. Okay. And control. And so I think the deeper problem behind materialism, it's actually scientism. Maybe this will open up some.
Thank you. I think what I'll do is go to each section of the room and then have a chance here. Frederick.
Thank you. I want to start with your remark and really ask a comment or question.
If you could speak loud so that people can hear you if possible.
You had it.
It's only
That, of course,
wondering whether this disappearance of nature that you refer to, referring to Lanza's work, in fact, is more akin to what Mohammed just talked about, namely what disappears is this purely material nature that was invented in the 16th, 17th century in Western Europe for very political, economic, and religious reasons. So I'm wondering whether you would consider, rather than saying it's a disappearance of nature, which seems, of course, to go against any ecological imperative, rather what disappears is precisely this purely material, quantifiable, exploitable,
good question,
insentient entity, and what emerges is that we are part and parcel, totally entangled with it, and therefore have more responsibility. And that what happened during the scientific revolution, it prevented us, is preventing, and it's still very dominant today. So perhaps these kinds of people, they may not do it very well. I've been reading Lanza and I've been a bit disappointed as well. What they're trying to do, and I think Karen Barad, the quantum physicist, feminist philosopher, does that very well. What it opens up is precisely an opening to, let us say, re-enchantment of the world and certainly responsibility on our part. Would you consider this?
If they were doing what you said they're doing, I think that I don't think Lanza's doing that. So what you're proposing to me is like vibrant matter. It's this, I think that's a very good way to go. It re-embeds us and it understands the bifurcation disappears, but it doesn't all meld into consciousness. So if that was the worldview that was emerging, that then would elicit more responsibility, more awareness, greater embeddedness, that would be great. I just don't think Lanza's doing that. And I think his term biocentrism is a co-optation of precisely that, which I think would be a good way to go. But that's my view. I could be wrong.
Either of you want to jump in?
If I can just add one quick comment. That's a really excellent question and observation. Just from a practical perspective, what I've noticed with my own students is I try to, in order to introduce them to this kind of worldview, it's to really just rock the boat a little bit and tell them, like I'll sometimes come in and say, you know, the Earth is at the center of the universe, and they'll just start laughing because we've all read in textbooks that it's, and then I say to them, why are you laughing? Have you verified that the sun is at the center of our universe? And then we start looking at outside the window, or sometimes we're outside teaching the class, and then I say, look, there's the sun, it's up there, and we're here. So just from a basic scientific perspective, using all the observational tools we have right now, we are at the center. Look, we're here, and it's over there. So I think there are ways you can, there are perhaps methods to like break down that heliocentric model for the understanding of things after the Copernican Revolution, not because it's not scientifically true, but just because it doesn't accord with our direct experience of nature.
No, I, before we ditch some of the accomplishments of science, we do need to acknowledge them. So I don't think that we should go too far doing that. We also need to understand that science always goes with technology, or it expresses itself in technology. Much of the damage to the natural world is a result of technology. So I'm not necessarily buying the move to go as far as you want to go. We need to do it, and we need to do it with caution and recognize that, no, we do not want to give up on some of the technological advantages.
I'm not suggesting that.
Yeah. Okay, so just realize where the danger lies.
Anybody in this side of the room? Yes, please.
I was just, I've been pondering ever since Heather threw out quite a challenge religions to be more relevant. And then followed up with those worldviews that are quite devastating to much of the history of religion.
Right.
You know, and
right.
Even the example that you used of you know, this focus on the next world and whether or not we actually should really drop that.
Right.
You were advocating. I just wondered from the rest of the panel how that radical revision of a world this radical division of religions who, even at one time, were defined as having some sort of ultimate otherworldly focus as quintessential to their being. But I know for my own students, this is a very, very difficult matter, you know, the question of whether or not there's any kind of life beyond this that most would dismiss. So I'd just like to hear the other people on the panel respond to that particular kind of point from their religious perspectives.
Challenging.
And Mary Evelyn suggested if you would speak more into the
the microphone.
Because it may be also for recording. So whoever would like to take that up.
Wow. Okay, well, when you were talking, actually, I was thinking she thinks like a Jew. In some ways, the critique of spirituality or the critique of transcendence as understood by the Christian tradition is precisely where the Jewish critique has been and still is. So when you want us to give up, or when you want Christians, not me, but when you want Christians to give up on the transcendence as understood by the tradition, I think you're asking an awful lot, and it's very difficult. From a Jewish perspective, my response would be, you don't have to give up on the transcendence. You have to give up on the thought that this is a perfect world. You have to give up on the thought that transcendence can be accomplished. In other words, you have to give up on incarnation. Not on transcendence, but on incarnationism. That's the bottom line difference, I think, between Judaism and Christianity. So if we live in an imperfect world, if we live in a world that requires to constantly engage in what the Jews call tikkun olam, the repair, the mending of the world, and it's a work that will never be done, it means that we live in a pre-messianic world. We are not living in a redeemed world. And if we don't live in a redeemed world, then you can aspire for the transcendent, but you will never get there. What Christianity promises us is spirituality here and now, and that's where Judaism challenges. So that would be my take as a Jew, but it's really a Christian business, I would say, to solve that problem.
There must be some Christians here.
There must be some Christians here, yeah.
That's a very good question. One of the pillars of faith in Islam is the belief in an afterlife. And I mean, we use words like afterlife or eschatology. The Arabic term, it's ma'ad, which means literally the place to where you return. So there is again that notion, the idea that you came from some place and you're just going back there, that's all. And there's a lot happening in between, and for that, you're culpable. But at the same time, many of these great authors in the Islamic tradition who have geared their lives towards this afterlife or this return have been the most world-affirming people. So if you look at, for example, the Amir Abdul Qadir al-Jazairi, who was a big Sufi sheikh, big spiritual master, he fought the French during that horrible period of colonial occupation in Algeria. He fought them so much they respected him. By the end of the battle, they respected him. He also defended them when the Muslims were treating them unjustly. And he was a warrior. He was a warrior, literally fighting, himself fighting. But he was also a great spiritual master. And so there's a principle in Islam which goes back to a saying of the Prophet where he says that if you're planting a tree and the day of judgment comes, you should finish planting that tree. So that means that there is a definitive responsibility you have towards nature as a living being like you, just like another human being. You can't abandon a human being no matter how spiritual you become. Remember the Prophet, he goes away to the mountain, receives a revelation, but he comes back to society and he lives with people and he goes on to form a religious polity. So the ideal has always been you should have, as they say, one foot in the afterlife and one foot in this life.
Thank you.
So it would be rather untenable to just do away with the afterlife.
Yeah, there's a Jewish midrash precisely on that. Yes. Score, exactly.
We're back on this side of the room. Yes, please.
Me?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Particular students that I teach. And it struck me
all that.
Yeah. And then in contrast, a stereotypical view of religion generally, and Christianity specifically, is that it's more conservative, it's more holding the tradition. And I even feel already that a lot of what we're talking about here is actually conservative in the way that we want to maintain the world the way it is rather than have it change drastically so we don't recognize it. But I find that intention, you know, where especially younger people really want that novel, innovative, flashy kind of perspective. And so I wanted to hear your thoughts about that tension, about religions being inherently conservative in relation to these sort of newer technological ideas. And also wondered if any of you could speak on any new forms in your respective traditions that you study that are being more novel or creative or maybe more attractive to young people. So I'm just trying to think about how the religions engage with these really challenging philosophical questions.
That's a great question. I agree with everything you said about why these two worldviews are very attractive to younger people. I think it makes sense to them. And I do think religions are conservative. I think they are loath to change, but I think that's not necessarily detrimental.
That's
I think
right.
They are conserving. So there's no quick answer to what you're saying, but so from my perspective of coming through the Christian tradition, sort of, and I'm a bit hesitant to say that anymore, I do think there's something about, at least in the monotheistic traditions, about discerning the ineffable. And one of the places you discern the ineffable is the natural world. The natural world is, in my view, reeks of ethics and aesthetics. You know, if you take ethics derived from aesthetics, the natural world is the place par excellence that you would do this. So what concerns me is the rapport with the natural world is being lost. So for me, religion and ecology should be doing that, more so than worrying about doctrines. That is a good place for young people because experientially that is a relatable realm. It's a relatable realm. I do think there's presence in the natural world. Now, I don't think that's just fiction, and maybe it's an illusion in our mind, but I just don't think so. Like, I'd stake my life on it, you know? I do think that what we're calling spirituality is not just a slippery, loosey-goosey term. I think it's actually got deep traction in the new materialism, in religion. It's not an old theory. It's the terre de Chardin. It's embedded. It's there. So I think that maybe we need new language for it. But, you know, Christianity, so in the Catholic tradition, sacramentality is a basic orientation. Reverence. These, to me, are enormously powerful sources of ethics, not just a wonderful experience. You know, they are truly sources of ethics. And when I read the biocentrism, which I loved the title, I thought it was going to be great, and I listened to him, I won't go there, but I think I'm a foundationalist, that what happens in the natural world determines the future. So when the natural world diminishes, so does the human imagination, so do human sensibilities. Like, it's not a technological fix. I'm not against technology. It's more, what is informing our imagination? What's informing our religious sensibilities? You know, there's our ideas, but then what informs our religious sensibility? What actually creates depth in a human person? What gives us some kind of moral grounding? And I think religions have huge resources there, and I still would say even the field of religion and ecology is not bringing those to the surface to the degree that it can. The traditions of animism, I mean, this is your work, Mark, these are really important, and I think young people, so I have a daughter who's 20, utterly allergic to religion. I mean, like, totally. But I think she's asking religious questions. I really do. I think they are. I think they're looking for something that makes sense. They're also looking for hope, which, seriously, we have a responsibility to answer to that one, our generation. So I think I'm a foundationalist in the sense of I just don't put all the stuff in consciousness studies that others would. I can't. I don't want a human-centric world.
As far as the role of the young person, let's say in Judaism, I would say the interesting thing that is going on, and maybe Natan and Ellen can comment on it, seems to me that there is a focus on activism.
You probably heard the term eco-kosher. Are you familiar, yeah? So eco-kosher basically is the Jewish version of eco-justice. So we have focus on eco-kosher, we have focus on the food movement. There's a lot of stuff that is going on in food movement. This activism really puts up front the value of responsibility. This is all good stuff that young people can get into. And we should not forget also vegetarianism. Vegetarianism can be a real force for mobilization of environmental consciousness. So in that sense, I think that it's forward-looking. However, I would also say, what's wrong with conserving? Mm-hmm. Conservation is a very good idea. Mm-hmm. And I don't like to speak about as contrary to Arnie Nass, I think that the idea of shallow ecology it's not a fair term to speak about those traditions as shallow ecology as opposed to deep ecology. Shallow ecology is good if we are conserving resources. Why give it up? We don't have to do it, we don't have to accept that critique. So the bottom line is there's a lot of room for positive activism.
Yeah, that's a very good question that you asked with respect to Islam. In English, there are one of the ways that the environmental consciousness has been, raised to a greater degree amongst English-speaking Muslims is through the writing of books like novels and literature. There is one creative book, it's called Green Deen. Deen in Arabic means religion. So that's not a novel as such, but at least the author, who is a very well-known environmentalist, Ibrahim Abdul-Mateen, he wrote this book with an interesting title, so it attracted a lot of people. And I believe since then, there have been, probably because of his book, there have been a lot of efforts in the area of children's literature to write books like Islamic eco-fables. My colleague Joseph Lombard, his wife, she's a very well-known writer of Islamic children's books, and she recently did an adaptation of a famous eco-fable amongst Muslims. There's a very old tale by the Ikhwan as-Saffah. It's about 1,000 years old, by like a literary community of Muslims. We don't even know who these people really were, but they wrote this book, which is kind of like an animal rights book 1,000 years ago, where the animals complain about the human abuses to them. It was very popular in the medieval period. It was translated into Hebrew, it was translated into Latin, and then it was readapted by my friend's wife into English. And we read them with our children. They love these books. So that's one literary avenue. But in terms of rearing children and what's being done there, there are all kinds of educational endeavors that are taking place on the internet. I've seen so many websites that are designed to like teach children about the environment. Again, more like the legal aspect, protect the environment because God wants you to. The most hands-on thing we've done is teach the children these books, these literary texts, and then also just take them on long walks, just take them, let them see nature. And my wife, she was reading a book called, I think it's called Last Child in the Woods.
Oh, yeah.
Is that? Yeah, and I have to admit, I haven't read the book because she gave me such a good synopsis of it. I felt like I read the book, and that like changed her whole view of what we're gonna do with the children. So we take them always on these long walks and hikes and things like this, just to get accustomed to nature. And the other day, my son, he turned to me and he said, God, he painted the whole world. Look at how he painted it. And I thought, that's so beautiful. Instead of using abstract language like creation, he's referring it to as something that he does in school, right? He himself creates these strange pieces of art at school with painting. And he looks out and he goes, well, I'm doing what God's doing. And then, of course, he goes home and he puts that painting on the fridge, and he admires it, and he reveres it. So by some strange analogy, he was able to say, well, then I should admire and reveal all of this around me. That was his own conclusion. So based on, I think, a very primordial contact with nature, and then intellectually, just getting accustomed to this form of literature in English.
Thank you. Next, we're back in the middle here. Yes, please, you've been waiting.
Yeah.
Well, Ellen, you know, this question is really for you if you want to, in case you want to say a word, but I'll say first and maybe Ellen can say more. First of all, you know, the Jewish practice is very concrete. So any child who grows up in a Jewish environment knows something about the holidays, right? So you cannot live the Jewish life. Let's take the festival that we are about to celebrate, Sukkot. Right? Sukkot is a wonderful environmental holiday. Actually, Ellen wrote all the exposition of how to understand the agricultural roots of Sukkot. Sukkot is a Feast of Tabernacles, Feast of Booths. How to understand it, how to inculcate it, how to experience it, how to unpack it historically, artistically, religiously, theologically. You can do an awful lot. And you can do the same thing with the other, of course, pilgrimage holidays, the two pilgrimage festivals. And you can do it, of course, with Shabbat, in a sense. What is Shabbat? Shabbat is one of the deepest ecological insights that Judaism gave humanity, the fact that we need a day of rest, that the human and the natural world cannot go on without rest. And rest is not in nature. Rest is imposed by God, according to the biblical narrative. So there's endless possibilities. Once you get to read the literature that has been already in existence for 20, 30 years, you will find endless possibilities to translate it into education. Now, within the educational school, Ellen, you can probably speak about specific materials. You live here, yeah, Nathan, yeah.
Yeah, no, there's a lot going on. I would say it's not just activism, but as Ellen was saying, these experiential programs, all the farming things going on, a lot of this in Massachusetts, and young people are getting into Judaism through their ecological concern, and they'll do these wonderful program called Adama, which is an internship in organic farming, and you also learn about Judaism through that. So there's a lot of great stuff going on. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Yeah. Okay, go over this side again. Yes, please.
It would really help clarify for me what the panelists would say where you are personally in where you think we are environmentally. I mean, I think it's not clear. Do you think we passed a tipping point? Mm-hmm. Do you think we're pre-tipping point? If you reset where you are, I can kind of infer, guess where you might be, but I think it's important because there are a lot of data out there of rising temperatures and stuff like that that would lead me to think that we're past the tipping point, but maybe you're not. Would you please clarify that?
Mm-hmm. Clear question for all three.
I guess it depends if you're a pessimistic or optimistic person, right? In a sense.
I think it's a
scientific issue. Look.
Yeah.
I don't feel myself competent to answer the question whether we have passed the tipping point, scientifically speaking. I think you need a scientist to answer that. I can only say that this is the only world we have, this is the only world we live in, and then the question is attitudinal and behavioral. And on that question, we go back to what we think, how we feel, and so forth. That's not a scientific issue for me. So let the scientists tell us whether we are before the tipping point or after the tipping point. I hope that we are not. I hope that there's still room for some action. Hmm. That's all I can say, right?
Scientific or non-scientific viewpoint?
I'm less optimistic, but to me the question is not so much optimism or pessimism. I do think that the planetary issues of climate instability is a fact. It's just we haven't got all of the, we can't predict what's going to happen, but we know that climate, it's not so much climate change, it's climate instability. So that's beginning. I think the issues of the state of the oceans, like every report on the state of the oceans is more catastrophic than the previous one. That's just, I mean, if the scientists are wrong, great, but I believe them.
I believe the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. I also think the period of, we are in the sixth extinction. It's true. There are not going to be large mammals on the planet unless they're deliberately protected. There's not going to be any left in the wild in 25 years, approximately. So these, to me, are catastrophic planetary changes. If you look at planetary systems and then you look at, you know, bioregional systems and ecosystems, there are certainly ecosystems that are intact, that are flourishing, that are doing well. But I'm sure there's some bioregions that are flourishing and doing well. At a planetary level, I mean, I'm not a scientist, but I pay attention to that. I don't know what a tipping point means. I'm not sure that language personally is useful, but are we in catastrophic, irreversible change? Yeah. However, one thing I like of St. Augustine, probably the only thing, is when he said, hope is comprised of anger and courage. Anger at the way things are, and courage to see that they don't remain the way they are. So hope to me is different than optimism. So hope, we have to work for hope. I mean, otherwise, why get out of bed? I just wouldn't link that to optimism. I would say it's a responsibility.
Mohammed,
Dave, the two panelists here who've spoken very eloquently throughout the panel, I agree very much with them on this point. The idea of some kind of impending damage or irreversible process or anything like that, I tend to just not think about, not because I'm unqualified to think about the scientific aspect of things, which is true, I am unqualified. But because it's kind of depressing to think about that, and I'd rather just focus on the things that I can do now, that I can change in front of myself, keeping in mind, of course, that I believe in God. I believe that the future is in God's hands, and that things will happen in the best possible way. But we're also very much responsible for how that's going to take place. Yeah. But in terms of like a more immediate effect of things, I don't know. I had a debate once with a colleague who works for the government of Canada, and you might even know him. He's a climate change expert, and we had a huge debate, and he said to me, all of this climate change stuff is nonsense. He totally didn't believe, he didn't even believe there was really an environmental crisis that was taking place, and he had all these charts and graphs to explain, and I said to him, look, I don't know about those numbers. All I know is I was born and raised in Toronto, and when I was a kid growing up, we had four seasons. They're beautiful seasons, and they were each very long. Today, we don't have a fall in Toronto. I mean, it's very short. It's like 4 weeks, 3 weeks tops. Our springs are like 2 weeks. The summer is like incredibly long. This past winter, judging again just on empirical facts, for the first winter, I think, in my life, we had not built a snowman. There just wasn't enough snow. And then the day we did get enough snow to build, when it was all mush, it was gone by the afternoon. Mm-hmm. So these things tell me that something imminent is near. I don't know what it is, and I hope it's nothing catastrophic. Mm-hmm. And I try to pray and do what I can to alter that in my little circles.
Thank you. So back on this side, I think it's really hard to pick out which hand was up first, but I think Mark has been waiting for a while.
Thank you all very much for your contribution. I like earlier the kind of interreligious dialogue that we were having around the three Abrahamic traditions, and I wanted to continue that. Mohammed, you talked about all things as living beings. God is pure consciousness, using a kind of image of a great chain of being with other beings, even so-called inanimate beings, also being bearers of consciousness. I wanted to ask Heather and Hava if in the Christian and Jewish traditions, respectively, if that's a way of understanding the world that you would feel comfortable with. Are there resources in Christianity and in Judaism that would picture the world as a communion of living beings? Certainly we think of ourselves as humans and the divine reality in that way. But what about rocks and plants and animals and landscapes and the atmosphere itself? Sometimes around the margins of religious studies, and you all three have been talking about this, shorthand for this is the new materialism or post-humanism or even perhaps provocatively something like neo-animism, which I kind of heard haunting, Mohammed, your comments. Mm. But how would you in Judaism and Christianity understand that notion of the world as living?
Okay, so here we're going to get into some rough edges, maybe. Some environmentalists, I won't mention name, but if you want, I'll give you some references, basically suggest that Kabbalah, and either Kabbalah or Hasidism, can be the framework for this kind of holistic worldview, which basically sees all all beings as created in the image of God. That's the gist of the new book by David Seidenberg, Kabbalah and Ecology. That's kind of the bottom line of what he's saying. And he brings, he marshals a lot of resources. So beginning even pre-Kabbalah, already rabbinic sources that he marshals to justify that reading. That all sounds good. That, by the way, ontologically speaking, that would work very well with, since Kabbalah is rooted in medieval ontology. It's basically it's what I would call Aristotelian Neoplatonism. So it fits exactly, it all comes from Muslim sources, and it fits very well with the outlook that Mohammed has outlined for us. Where does the problem come in? The problem comes in the meaning of creation, the doctrine of creation. How seriously are we gonna take creation? How do you understand creation? You really need to get into that to see that that Kabbalah kind of what I would call fudged the issue of creation and basically spoke about creation as emanation. And I've written on it, you can take a look at it, but basically the fudged the problem. But if you're really consistent, believe in creation consistently, you really need to go for the focus on transcendence. Whereas in Kabbalah, the focus is on immanence. And those issues don't go away. You can try to work it out somehow, but there is a problem. So my critique, and they don't like it, but I don't always stand where David Seidenberg is because I want to protect the belief in creation much more seriously. I want to protect transcendence, and I don't want to mesh it as he does. So that's kind of where some of the fault lines lie within the Jewish tradition. Do we have sources? We have sources for everything. What do we do with them? You know, that remains to be seen. I my position is closer, you can say, maybe to the Orthodox position. And that means that the human is precious, that the human is unique. I don't want to give on the preciousness of the human. And it means, and that's part of my critique of transhumanism. Robert Nevin knows that I work on those issues here. I pretty much speak against transhumanism and posthumanism precisely because of the fact that they want to give on all the preciousness of being human. And I don't want to do it. So that's kind of where the issues lie.
Heather?
There are many resources, actually, on animism, and I think, Mark, you've written most of them, so just to start there, I think some of the best work is not the great chain of being. I think that's not a good, it's too hierarchical, and it's too, the discreteness among the differentiations, I think, is not helpful, but you, of course, know the communion of beings is one way to go, Earth community. You take the Imago Dei and you enlarge it. I think there's a lot of old traditions that support that spirituality is an embedded dimension that emerged, and evolutionary sciences will support that. I think what's interesting is the image of God, where is it located, how is it located in the Christian tradition, against this book, Homo Deus. I think that's really the major difference between the two. And I do think, as you said, the new materialism is a good way to go. And I do think your books should be read on this because they're pretty much the topic of animism and Christianity.
Thank you. Back in the middle here, Teresia, I think, was next.
Thank you.
And speak loud enough so everyone can hear, if you can.
About economics, one of the first comments was about that, and to Mohammed, there is talk about Islamic banking systems as an alternative, the Riba banking system as an alternative to the
capitalistic system, yeah.
How widespread is that thought in the Islamic context?
Yeah.
I also wanted to go back to your earlier comment when you're talking about animism and Islam, you say that a Muslim from Senegal talked about the importance of protecting trees, that you are going to have trees. And my question was, is that an African thought shining through, or a Muslim thought shining through, or both being energizing each other?
Yeah.
Now, in terms of resources in Judaism, I was reminded about by your discussion about the Jubilee movement.
Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That took resources from the biblical world.
Yeah.
The Leviticus, the Jubilee, you know, to push the case for forgiving debt,
yeah.
And also to push the case for ecological Sabbath.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. The sabbatical year, the Shemitah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And for Heather, the question of salvation and Christianity, I'm thinking what we have are competing ideas of what constitutes salvation. And in the African context, the view that our salvation lies beyond this world sometimes it's taken more seriously and at the expense of traditional understandings of salvation that says you are not saved alone and that salvation is not in the future. So,
so we're at the two-minute warning, and if you could each take a little stab at it, and then it can continue during the coffee breaks. If you want to each give a little stab or not. But.
Okay, the Jubilee movement. Okay, yeah, you know, you raised a very good point. The Bible itself basically offers us environmental models to follow in our 21st century. Shemitah, the sabbatical year, the seventh year, is one of the major paradigms, if not the major paradigm, for environmentalism, especially in Israel, more in Israel than here, of course. So there's quite a lot being done on the ground, how to make it part of a way to be Jewish today in the 21st century. So I think the Jubilee, the idea of debt relief or debt release, that's something that we can think about. Everything has a price. Everything, you're going to pay it somewhere else. You have to think it through. What does it really mean and how do you really work? So it's the fact that something is just there as an idea doesn't mean, how do you put it in practice? That's a challenge. I'll just put it that way.
The problem with salvation is when humans are seen as separate from all of the rest of the natural world and are saved elsewhere. And there was a bumper sticker on a car in the parking lot at my university, the beautiful iconic picture of the Earth from space, and then Jesus, don't leave Earth without him. That's the problem with salvation.
Okay. Excellent. And Mohammed gets the last word, probably.
You asked a few questions, so I'm going to try to just deal with if I have time, I'll.
You only
try
have
to get
a minute.
Minute? All right. The Islamic banking question is interesting. It's a 400 to 500, some say even $700 million industry a year. Islamic banking, or what they call halal banking. There have been too many abuses of the system in North America alone. Some of these larger companies in the early 2000s and even just recently. They caved in, or they're revealing some corrupt financial practices. So it's something that has to be tweaked somewhat. A friend of mine, he runs the largest Islamic banking company in North America. So he is of the view that this is very important for the future for Muslims. I have an uncle who wrote a book against Islamic banking, and he's an economist. And the thesis he puts forward, which has not been dealt with by Muslim scholars because they lack the training in modern economics, is that what we call riba or interest in the contemporary economic system does not qualify as interest in traditional Islamic legal texts, which means that if he's right, and if that's a discussion that can be had, then the whole industry goes down the tubes. And there are other many legal implications. I know people who, for example, don't take mortgages or student loans because they feel that there's interest, which is forbidden in Islamic law to use or to give out. But if that's not actually interest, according to the traditional definitions and given what we know about modern market systems, then the playing field changes significantly.
Okay. Thank you. So we have one announcement before the break, but the break is 15 minutes, stretch, restroom, coffee. We'll begin at 3:15 again. You don't feel you have to rush back into the room. Like, you're not going to get in trouble if you're not back here. But
yes,
basically,
well,
come in quietly if you come in. But John has an announcement before we break.
Before we give the panelists our applause, I'm told that there was one follower of the those of Confucius who never made a mistake without realizing it. Yan Hui has that characteristic. And I wanted to follow up on a mistake that I'd made. I had occasion to draw attention to those that supported, and Marty Kaplan and Wendy Kaplan at either end, and Dick and Nancy Clavins here have joined us, and Irene Krerup has also joined us from the Vicon Rasmussen. And I'm very pleased to draw attention to those early supporters and so much give our gratitude and thanks for the panel. Okay.